Hi there, my name's Jeremy Thomas, and I am the host of Shed Talks. Shed Talks hopes to be an entertaining, informative podcast that looks at well-being and mental health. And I hope you're going to like it. I'm going to be in conversation with well-known, interesting figures. Now, when it gets to the end of that conversation, don't rush off, because we have got the illustrious, wondrous psychologist Karen Cowan on hand to discuss what's been said and to give us some insight and various tips on what we can do with our mental health. It's all going to be great. Enjoy. So, welcome to episode 16, and our guest is the wonderful and funny, who am I going to tell you?
You're watching Newsnight with me, Kirsty Wark. They tried to make me go to rehab, I said no, no, no.
Hello, I'm Nigella Lawson, the reason Kleenex shareholders drive round in Rolls Royces. Summer is a time of year when fruit is at its plumpest.
During this election campaign, many people have asked, what will Britain be like post-Brexit? Will it be a more equal society? And to those people I say this, do you have permission to talk to me, you snivelling peasant?
Yes, you might be forgiven for thinking our guest is suffering from multiple personality syndrome, or is many people at the same time, but she's not. Yes, that was, of course, the gorgeous and multi-talented Jan Ravens. Jan is best known as an actress and impressionist, and for being the linchpin, spark plugs, carburettor, and shiny bonnet of the long-running radio and TV series Dead Ringers. Jan kickstarted her career while still at university by becoming the first woman president of the Cambridge Footlights Society, followed by another first, directing and starring in the Cambridge Review, which won the inaugural Perrier Award at the Edinburgh Festival. Wow. Since then, she has become a stalwart of radio and telly, appearing on many shows such as Spitting Image, The Grimleys, Strictly Come Dancing, and even winning Celebrity Mastermind. And if that's not enough, she's the mother of three boys, Alfie, Lenny, and Louie. Is there anything this woman can't do? Jan, welcome.
Well, thank you. I'm overwhelmed with that introduction.
Well, when we spoke to Ian Rankin, he was quite funny. He said, well, that's it, then I'll go home now. You don't need
it anymore. Can't top that.
Absolutely brilliant to have you on the show. Really, really brilliant. And I didn't realise that footlights thing, having investigated it, you had some minor talent on that show.
Yeah, I did. And actually, I do have to correct one of your accolades, because I wasn't actually in the show that I directed. I just directed it, and indeed there was no need for my talents, because Emma Thompson was there to hold the fort, bless her. Emma Thompson, Hugh Laurie, Stephen Fry, and Tony Slattery.
Much talent there at all.
No, they were quite the bunch.
Gosh, extraordinary. One question, because I spent quite a lot of time researching this. Have you always been a really confident person?
No, not at all. I was apparently, I mean, I don't remember much about my childhood, actually, which I think tells you something, but I was quite nervous, and I was always, I was quite nervous, and it wasn't really till I was a teenager that I did become more confident. And it's a very, you know, well-trodden, much rehearsed story of the kind of becoming the class clown and, you know, doing the impressions and so gaining everybody's, but also actually what happened, in a, well, I suppose an equally superficial way, was that as a sort of preteen, I was quite sort of, I was quite chubby, and I was never very sort of physically confident. And I wasn't sporty. So I wasn't like a physically confident person anyway. But when I was 13, I was very ill for about 3 months.
Oh.
And I lost a lot of weight, and I emerged, you know, out of my chrysalis, the beautiful skinny butterfly. And suddenly, you know, Jamie Lancaster at the school disco was asking me for a dance. And I thought, yeah, Jamie.
About time, matey.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so great. So that's out of adversity comes this fantastic thing.
Well, yeah. Yeah, but I don't, you know, I mean, I look back at things I've done over my life and I think, how did I do that? And I kind of think, I think you sort of have to make yourself do things sometimes.
But I have a sense with you, and this isn't sort of blowing smoke, whatever that rude expression is. You know, if somebody said to me, look, if you go up to the top diving board and just go to the end and then just dive off it, okay, I wouldn't start the journey. But you would. I mean, I'm just saying that you don't lack. You've obviously got some extra special thing in your DNA that goes, do it anyway.
Feel the fear and do it anyway. Yeah. Yeah, I guess that's right. And I think that sort of started probably when I was at college in Cambridge. I think, you know, there, I think I was so aware of the opportunities that were there that I felt kind of amazed to have, yes, you know, yes, Janet from, yes, Hoylake kind of thing. And I'd sort of got into Cambridge by the side entrance. You know, I was at the teacher training college, but we could do all the university drama things. We could do the footlights. But even on my own course, you know, they said, okay, we've all got to do our project for this big project for the end of this year. You know, what are you going to do? And I said, well, I'm going to write, direct and choreograph a musical, which is an adaptation of the medieval Marathi play, Every Man, based around Beatles songs. And this was before Mamma Mia, Jeremy. So this was, you know, the first jukebox musical. And so I sort of terrified myself by setting myself this challenge. And then I directed the University Gilbert and Sullivan and choreographed it. I mean, I don't know what I thought I was doing.
But I mean, sometimes amazing, you went for it. I mean, but had you, no trick question here, had you ever failed at anything? I mean, I'm saying that because, you know, sometimes when people fail, it's brilliant, but sometimes it can be, thank you so much, I'm never, ever doing that or anything like it again. I mean, because that's a big thing that you took on there, but you just went, right, I'm going to do it.
Yeah, they kind of worked out. And I think they partly worked out, actually, because I reached out to people, you know, not to be afraid to ask for help. And the best directors as well are the directors that give the performers confidence. I mean, directors that, you know, I work with as an actor. If a director gives you the courage to fail, that's when the best ideas happen, when you've got the courage to fail.
Yeah.
So we all need to sort of have that for ourselves and to try and enable it in the other people that we're working with, I think.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think that's great because that was quite a huge thing you did. I'm just saying, from 20 to 60 to, you know, 90, blindly. But you did it. You know, and I wonder, I know that you were at the wonderful West Kirby Grammar School for Girls, a top school on the Wirral. And I know, and we've got to get this in because it's so topical, that you were a big fan of Glenda Jackson, who was an ex-pupil.
Well, Glenda was an ex-pupil, yeah, a very much a local heroine. And her dad actually was our builder, Tom Jackson. Right. And all the guys at the, you know, the guys at the rugby club where I used to go to the discos would call me Glenda because they knew that I sort of, you know, did a bit of acting and wanted to be. And I'd say, all right, Glenda, you know. And I once was on in Billy's newsagents on Market Street in Hoylake, and I suddenly heard this voice going, 20 Benson and Hedges and a packet of Wrigley's Spearmint, please. And I sort of thought, whoa! And, and there she was.
Gosh,
Glenda, yeah, but my what an actress though, and what a career and what a life, amazing. Yeah, she was really great. I mean, you know, even the Morecambe and Wise shows, comedy, brilliant.
I thought,
like,
that,
what I have got. Yeah,
no, that's, I can see that she would be, my goodness. And she was all sort of, I went to work at Boots, thank you very much, and you know, she was really, you know, plain talk, plain food. Isn't that right? I mean,
very, very much so. Yeah. I mean, I never met her, although she did once send me when I was doing this, another mad thing that I did a few years ago now was I did this boat race for people from Oxford, people from Cambridge who hadn't rowed before. And we were sent messages, you know, the way they do on these programs. Yeah. It was for a telly program. And for the telly program, they made messages. And they knew that Glenda was a heroine of mine. So they got Glenda Jackson to do a message for me. And Jan, I know that you're going to do Wirral proud, you know. And it was so amazing. Just so brilliant.
That's the sort of your mental scrapbook. Really good, isn't it?
Yeah.
Something like that.
She wasn't put off by anything being, you know, controversial or physically difficult or exposing.
Yes.
Very sort of, yes, it's all raw and kind of here it is. And I'm not that kind of actor, really. I don't access that, you know, strip me down and, you know, build me up again kind of thing. I don't really access that. I don't think I clocked when I was young that's what she was. I just sort of saw that, you know, one minute she was at the Royal Shakespeare Company and the next minute she was in Hollywood. And I thought, that's what I want. I want to kind of straddle, you know, those worlds like she did. I sort of obviously took a very, you know, my path was very different because my skills are very different.
Yeah. But I mean, inspirational and as I'm sure you are. I mean, but I mean, anyway, just to sort of park in the lay-by for a second that, you know, with this show, what we try and do is always to find people who have either had direct experience of their own sort of poor mental health and how it got terrible and then how it got better, or we find people who have experienced it in other people. You know, I've always believed that's a very useful thing because so many people are alone in this. And, you know, especially if you're young, if you're very young, quite good news to hear other people, older people's experience. And on that note, so I thought what we would do, and you know, I hope you don't mind, but we want to go back in time to Bebington, I think, was where you were born. I did find out that was very near where John Peel lived.
And
I thought that there was a hugely fantastic coincidence that his real name was Ravenscroft and obviously connected to you.
I know, and we wrote him letters when we were what he referred to as schoolies, and sent him a photograph of ourselves in our bikinis. Can you believe this? And he wrote back in this beautiful cursive script, sort of italic script, actually. But it was all about Ian Callaghan and, you know, the current Liverpool team of which we were all fans.
Right.
Yeah. It was really lovely of him to write back. And he didn't say, and please come and see me at this aforementioned caravan or anything like that. So, you know.
Great. Well, that's a nice story. So your mum and dad, and I'm not going to complete the poem, but you had an interesting childhood, if that's not wrong. I mean,
it was very much overshadowed by my dad's mental illness. And there are a lot of things that I now know about my dad that I never knew at the time. But at the time, as a child, my dad, when I was very little, when I was about four or five, was away in hospital for, I think, a number of months. Because he had tried to take his own life.
Right.
And not for the first time, I later found out. And of course, I didn't know that he tried to do it then either. I just knew that, daddy had gone to hospital. He had been diagnosed as schizophrenic.
Right.
But I think that in the 60s, many people were diagnosed as schizophrenic. I mean, his symptoms were sort of partly schizophrenic and partly bipolar. You know, he had periods when he was very, very up and periods when he thought he was the worst person in the world and everything was his fault, and very, very down. And indeed, I think when he was in the Navy, when he was very young, had tried to end his life.
Because of that, because of the low moods?
Who knows why? I never talked to him about it. And my mum indeed didn't know about it when she married him. And my mum married him thinking he was just a nice bloke in the office, because they both worked at Threlfall's Brewery in Liverpool.
Right.
And in the office there. And he was just kind of a nice guy. He was quite funny. He was kind. He was, you know, he was
gentle.
You know, He was gentle and just like a nice guy. Anyway, they got married, and 6 months later, he was in at the depths of despair and I think tried to take his own life again.
Right.
So that would have been like 1955 or something. And then when he did it again, when I was little, that was probably 1963. So he got taken off to this hospital near Chester called Deva.
Right.
Which your scholarly listeners will know is the Roman name for Chester. So he got taken off to Deva. And there was I remember at school, I was like, your dad's a loony, your dad's in Deva. Right. I don't know how kids knew that. And as a result of that, he could, because he was very bright and very funny, but he'd never like passed any exams really, you know, beyond school. He was supposed to, you know, be a chartered accountant. He was put in to be things,
yes.
Mum and Dad's generation. Yeah. And he was put in to be an accountant, but he never could pass the exams because of his illness. And so he spent his whole life being a clerk.
Right.
So I sort of think sounds like, you know, he's Bob Cratchit or something, you know, sitting at a high school with a long pen and being very cold. Yeah, so he was a clerk for Liverpool Corporation, and consequently we were always short of money, and we were kind of operating in quite a middle class sort of milieu. Like my mum and dad's parents had been sort of like middle management sort of people.
Yes.
Who'd moved over from Liverpool to the Wirral, you know, and had a little, you know, had a 3-bedroom semi and had done quite nicely.
Yes.
My dad's dad was a sort of manager at Threlfall's Brewery, and my mum's dad had been a reporter for the Liverpool Echo and then had become a sort of head of personnel or something like that. So everybody was like in a middle class sort of world, but yeah, without having the wherewithal to kind of finance it. So yeah, there was always a sort of slight running to catch up thing.
What were you aware of? I mean, were you aware of that, of what you've just said, like that it was always not enough money, this, that? Were you not aware of it? I mean,
I think I was aware. I was aware of my mum working very hard, because she had to go out to work as well. And, you know, that was quite hard with, you know, with having us, because like obviously she could work when we were at school, and, you know, but then she worked very hard when she got, you know, because she took care of the whole business at home. You know, my dad was no help with that.
Yeah.
And we just sort of didn't have some of the things that like my friends at school would take for granted. Like, I mean, there was one stupid one that I remember in particular was there was this doll, a bit like Barbie, that was around when I don't know if Barbie was around. But anyway, there were two dolls, like, you know, grown up sort of teenage dolls that were around when I was a kid. And one was called Cindy and one was called Tressie. And Tressie had hair that came out of her head. Her hair grows. Well, no, a whole sort of thing comes out of the top of her head. Anyway, there was Tressie and Cindy, and I desperately wanted a Cindy, but I couldn't have a Cindy because a Cindy was too expensive. I had to have this one called Susie that was like the sort of Toys R Us version. No, actually, I think at that point it was actually from Billy's newsagent. But it was, you know, it was like, oh, but I really wanted Cindy. Cindy had the Brit on top and the little jeans, you know. I mean, stupid things like that. And, you know, our holidays every year would be at my Auntie Pat's cottage in Snowdonia every bloody year. You know, we'd hire a Ford Popular and drive off to Snowdonia every year. So things like that. I mean, it wasn't terrible. It wasn't like we didn't have enough to eat.
Yes.
It was, yeah. And, you know, it's not. I mean, I don't mean to sound sort of poor me about that, because...
No, but I think it's good.
It was like deprivation on a very, very kind of, you know, very, very low level deprivation. But my mum, you know, she shopped very carefully, cooked, you know, she used leftovers. I think a lot more of that went on anyway. And you know, she baked, you know, she made all my clothes, you know.
But, I mean, with your dad, was there, when he had an attack or whatever he wants to call it, because this is interesting because we haven't had anybody on Shed Talks talking about schizophrenia. And I suspect that you're right, that maybe it was a mix. But I mean, how did that manifest for you? I mean, on a positive note, you know, I read somewhere that you used to watch Peter Cook and Dudley Moore, not only but also with him. And that must have been great. I mean, a sort of...
Yeah, he loved comedy. And he introduced me to P.G. Woodhouse, and we used to watch, you know, Beachcomber and Q, you know, all the Spike Milligan Q8, Q9 programs, and Peter Cook and Dudley Moore and Monty Python. And my mum thought it was a load of bloody rubbish, you know, but my dad was really into all that. And my dad really loved the Beatles as well, which, because, you know, he was at the same school as John Lennon and all that. So we both loved all that. But I knew he wasn't strong. You know how people say, oh, my dad, you know, my father figure.
Yeah.
He never felt like that. He always felt like somebody that was...
leaning on you a bit.
Not leaning on me, no. No, he felt like somebody that was baffled by life. And he felt like... I mean, I remember actually once when my first boyfriend... I mean, he was so sweet. Remember when I had my heart broken for the first time. I was in the lounge listening to the radiogram, you know, listening to James Taylor or something and crying and just crying and crying and crying because this, you know, boy didn't want me anymore. And my dad came in and he just came in and he said, oh, love, you know, I wish there was something I could do. It was so sweet and touching. And yet, you know, then I remember these sort of arguments with my mum, where my mum would always come off better because she always kind of had the moral high ground. Because one of the things all his doctors had apparently said to her was that he must have his, you know, his pleasures. He must keep up his season tickets at Liverpool. He must go to the municipal golf club and have his game of golf on a Sunday. It's very important for his mental well-being that all this goes on. Nothing about her well-being.
Yeah.
So, you know, she would sort of, I can remember sort of things like, you know, she'd cook the Sunday lunch and he would go to the golf club and then he'd maybe go to the bar and have one too many. So she'd have done the lunch and she'd, you know, the meat would be drying up and the potatoes were burning and he'd get back. And then I have this memory of him washing the dishes and crying.
Really?
And that's the kind of really sort of dominant image of my dad in my life, a man who's kind of beaten.
Yes.
A man who's got no way of sort of making it better. He's guilty, you know, he's diminished.
And no way out.
And no way out. And okay, you know, there's a sort of an element of his selfishness in there because he was getting, you know, his football and his golf and all that palaver. But nonetheless, he was doing this, you know, he was going out at 7:30 in the morning and coming back at, you know, 6:00 at night on the train to Liverpool to do this job that wasn't, you know, that wasn't any fun, that was basically just sort of adding things up and coming home again. You know, again, that's what lots of people's life is. But
he knew he was better than that.
Well, I don't know if he knew that he was, but he was. Because he was bright and been, I think he would have been like really good at languages. If, you know, he loved languages and he loved language. Both he and my mum were funny. They were both funny in their way, you know. And he sort of reminded me a bit of Eric Morecambe.
Yeah, right.
You know, he looked a bit like he had that sort of, you know, the wavy hair and the glasses. But he wasn't a strong role model, and I've never been able to sort of quite work out what that's done to my relationship with men. You know, having a father that was not strong. And was diminished and was, and I sort of always felt that he was the underdog and that I needed to be on his side because I knew sort of my mum was strong.
Yes. And presumably that became sort of mixed up because you liked your mum a lot. You could see.
Yeah, I could see it from her point of view as well.
And inevitably in those situations, there's resentment from mother going, oh, blimey, you know, who's doing all that around here? You know, I'm keeping on together, you're bringing off. I think it's a very interesting thing. And I think it's very important that people are honest about this because, you know, one can have sort of terrible guilt, you know, oh my God, I didn't do enough. I should have stood up for him or I felt really shameful about him, you know, or whatever. And I think people, it's cliche, but you said, you know, people now have got no idea. But really, I mean, in many ways they haven't. But at the same time, there are still some people, I think, nowadays who go, excuse me, we are not discussing that. And that doesn't go out the front door. Thank you so much. And yes, Uncle Rodney, you know, stays up on the first floor and you don't engage. You know, there can be an awful thing with people who have mental illness. There can be terribly lonely and feel feel that sort of different loneliness. They can't transcend things, and
it can't be explained.
I mean, and then you have that option where you go, well, I'll just end it all. Then you have the recrimination for wanting to do that or doing it and not making it work. And so, yeah, I mean, I'm very grateful that we're talking about that. I think it's a really interesting thing.
I mean, the other thing is that, of course, as I grew older, I mean, as a little girl, I was just aware of, you know, I was aware of the tensions and, you know, these horrible arguments and the, you know, the fact that my dad wasn't sort of happy and that my mum was kind of cross and frustrated. But as I grew older, I kind of realized how hard it was on my mum, having sort of been thinking, oh, my poor dad. I sort of, you know, I realized that my mum was in this kind of impossible position where she was sort of like the caregiver. You know, she was having to help, you know, earn the money. She was taking care of us because he wasn't doing any of that. She was doing the whole, you know, house business. I'm taking care of his dad, by the way, who was living with us about part of this time. And, you know, where was her life? Where was her there? And, you know, in the end, she had a nervous breakdown. And the other thing about both of them is both their mothers died when they were 13. And they then had like a stepmother that didn't care about them.
Right.
A wicked stepmother, if you like, figure. And
was it one of your grandparents, a grenadier guard?
Yes, that was my mum's dad. And he would say, you don't complain to any, you know, you don't tell anybody, you know, your problems. You're the daughter of a grenadier guard.
Yeah.
And but I mean, that's what everybody was doing in those days. Nobody was telling each other about their problems with mental illness. It was a shaming thing. And you know, you couldn't talk about it. I mean,
did your mum get involved in any of the sort of new literature that was coming out at that point? I mean, like R.D. Lang.
No, but I became aware of that later. And yeah. I know that the whole kind of schizophrenic thing became quite a sort of, not trendy, but it was like, was being diagnosed.
It was trendy. It was like Hermann Hesse.
Yeah.
You know, the glass bead game, and haven't you got that? Haven't you got the divided cell?
Yes.
So, I mean, interesting, because it's very easy to look back and go, cool, blimey.
My mum wasn't really a reader. I think my mum was probably dyslexic.
Right.
She didn't really read much. She did, at some later stage, get involved with her aunt. You know, she was Christian Scientist.
Right.
I remember my mum bringing home the LP of Jonathan Livingston Seagull and all these kind of funny books. And
oh, right, yes. Anyway,
then she became an absolutely very, very strong atheist, had a humanist funeral. Yeah, couldn't be doing with any of it.
Really?
She was like, yes, it's all a load of rubbish, and I don't want any of that at my funeral.
Did that affect you in that way? In the faith department, I mean, was that...
Well, something? I mean, the faith department was... I think I was all the time looking for some kind of certainty or some kind of, you know, life raft to hang on to in this sort of, like, you know, because everything sort of felt a bit like this. Everything felt a bit unbalanced and perilous. Mm. And I think I wanted some certainty in my life. And so I was kind of quite into religion, and I was indeed, when I was a teenager, I was a Sunday school teacher. And I, you know, there's still a lot, you know, about the Bible that I love. What I sort of realized quite early on, I remember asking the minister, it was a Presbyterian church I was at, and I sort of said to the minister when I was doing confirmation classes, but my granddad is an atheist. This is the Grenadier Guard, who was very much a self-made, self-taught man. He'd read all of Shakespeare, and even though he left school at 14, blah, blah, blah. So does that mean he wouldn't go to heaven? And the minister said, yeah, that's right. He wouldn't go to heaven. So yeah, but he's a really good man. You know, he's a really good man. He's a kind man. He does, you know, this for that person and that, and he's a charity thing, and he does this. No. He's not. If he doesn't accept Jesus as the Lord, you know, that's it.
Right.
And I think that was my first sort of like confrontation with fundamentalism. You know, in that sort of, you know, this is a fundamental kind of point that it's our way or the highway kind of thing. And
yes.
You know, that's the way it is.
Yes.
And I kind of thought, oh, okay. Well, I think I, you know, so I got confirmed and everything, but I was already sort of thinking, I think I need something a bit more adaptable. And so, and I really envied people, you know, like Thora Heard, that would say, yeah. Oh, I talk to my mate, God, and I say, look here, God, I'm in a bit of trouble. And he says to me, and I think, what are you thinking, Thora? Thinking you're talking to here? You know, what's going on? And while at the same time being absolutely incredulous, I'm also incredibly envious.
Yeah, of course. In the certainty.
Yeah, because I think that's such a lovely thing. But well, the rest of us have to sort of carry on questioning. And
I think the certainty thing, really, we need to set up a public company called Certainty and sell shares. And, you know, and off we go. I just want to say a little tiny bit more about your parents or dad in that situation, because I think it's quite important that, especially with schizophrenia, you can have paranoid schizophrenia, which is where it really gets very tricky indeed. But, you know, a lot of people think, oh, schizophrenia, my God, you know, and that no one quite realizes that all of this stuff can be managed and can be dealt with, even then, you know, with the medication that they had then. Now, schizophrenia is totally managed by medication, and you wouldn't know.
I mean, he had electric shock treatment as well, and I think he was, like, in straitjackets and all sorts. I think it was very grim.
Although I think electric shock treatment actually can, that's
well, it's kind of come back into use, hasn't it?
Yeah, well, a lot of people think it's actually quite good. Not as a last resort in a form of torture, but I think last resort as in, well, look, all the medication hasn't worked, so what are you going to do?
And but isn't it now done sort of under anaesthetic as opposed to not under anaesthetic?
Yes, I think that's correct, yeah. And also that one flew over the cuckoo's nest has a lot to answer for.
Yeah.
In that respect, because it's sort of like everyone went, oh my God, having that. But that was, I mean, the only good thing about that was Nurse Ratched, but it was brilliant. I suppose that's the other thing, that final question.
Yeah.
On that subject was that, were you quite hurt, quite angry, by what people said to you, you know, teasing or whatever, and were you angry about the situation, you know, that it wasn't, you know, it wasn't a two Rolls Royces in the drive and, you know, fantastic holidays or whatever?
No, I definitely wasn't angry. I mean, I wasn't expecting the two Rolls Royces in the drive, because it wasn't that. I mean, nobody had that. People kind of, you know, went to a holiday camp in Cornwall, and I thought that was, you know, exciting. It wasn't a Rolls Royce. It wasn't a gin and jags kind of setup where I grew up.
Right.
Although I know a lot of people think the Wirral is like that, but much of the Wirral is very much not. Anyway, no, I wasn't angry. I think it just made me feel, I think the best way I can describe it sort of psychically is that I just felt afraid. I felt insecure. I felt like a nameless dread. I felt something was like different about our family, and I didn't know quite what it was, but it didn't seem to be like other people's families where it was kind of ordinary. It's like, you know, kids want to be the same as other kids, don't they? They want to fit in. And I felt that, and I felt we didn't fit in. And, you know, subsequently, like, you know, friends who were my friends when I was a teenager said to me, you know, oh God, I used to love coming around your house. It was such fun, you know, and your mum was so great and all that. And they were, you know, but I am sort of talking more about being a little girl, you know, being sort of up to sort of age 10 or 11 or something, where I didn't know what was going on. And actually, yeah, I think it was much more scary, although it was upsetting hearing my mum telling all these stories of what had happened through the years before. It was kind of better. And I felt armed, you know, I felt okay. Well, I know what I'm working with here now. And also, as I said, you know, I'd sort of gained some confidence by then. And I knew that I was bright. I knew that I was, I knew that I could do something. And I knew that I wanted to leave. I knew I wanted to get out of this sort of very lower middle class suburban northwestern world. And I sort of felt that I could. But as a little girl, I didn't like being a little girl. I didn't like the lack of power. I didn't like the, you know, girls in the playground that would say, you know, we're going to break friends with you. We're not your friend anymore. And, you know, you'd never know from one day to the next where you stood and you know, whether you were in or out. And like I said, I wasn't good at sport. So that was like, I mean, it didn't matter that much, but it was just another thing, you know, that, oh my God, will I be able to catch this horrible hard ball? You know, and, oh, no, I won't. And like that bit in Parenthood, you know, with Steve Martin and the Little League game.
Yes. Extraordinary. Did your dad get to witness your success?
Yes, to some extent. To some extent. You know, they'd come and see me in productions at Cambridge. I remember they came to see me. In fact, he was quite ill then when he came to see me in a play at Chichester in the mid-80s. So, yeah, to some degree, I think. So he would have died in 1999.
Oh, right.
So, yes, he would have seen me on the telly. And I mean, he didn't sort of see me doing Dead Ringers on the telly. Oh, and he didn't see me doing Strictly. So he didn't see me, you know, when I sort of got to be a bit more of a, you know, a figure. But he saw me be successful and he saw me do good things on the telly. And
well, that's great, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
That's a good ending for him. It was a good ending.
Yeah. And do you know what was weird? His huge fear throughout his life was that he would die of cancer. He feared cancer very, very much. And he got cancer. He was diagnosed with lung. He'd become very breathless. And, you know, my mum was going, for God's sake, come on, you know, and, you know, buck up and all this. Turned out he had lung cancer. And when he got lung cancer, he took on this kind of beatific sort of serenity. It was quite strange. And it was like, well, I've had a good innings. They think, well, you haven't really. It's been a bit crap. But he was like, no, well, you know, I've had a good innings and, you know, I've been very lucky. But anyway, he became very philosophical and did that thing, that sort of Dennis Potter seeing the blossom thing of like seeing clouds. And look at those clouds, Jan. You know, look at the...
Amazing.
I mean, he was coughing his guts off and everything, but he was able to sort of, you know, he suddenly seemed to sort of, this is the end.
It just maybe had a final sort of big sort of acceptance thing.
Well, maybe he was glad to be going.
Yeah, but like it's, yes, that's right. I've got the ticket.
Yeah.
And that will be that. And yeah. Oh, thank God I've got it, actually. But it's almost like it's Christmas Day and your birthday. You know how that is, you know, where you're supposed to be nice to everybody and, you know, everything's wonderful. I mean, I don't know, but it...
Yeah,
maybe but for him it was, you know, well, hey, it's not that frightening. I'm not worried about it. And that's probably a very big deal for him, perhaps, because it's like overcoming a major fear, you know.
I suppose he'd faced it before, you know, he'd faced death before. He'd wanted it.
Yeah.
Strange that. I hadn't really thought about that very much.
What was his name? I'm sorry, I don't know.
Alan. Yeah.
All right.
Ravens. And of course, after he died, my mother was so wound up with kind of bitterness and guilt and saying, well, of course he did this and he did that. And it was like, which was so awful because I did not want to hear that then.
No.
But she needed to sort of, you know, vent this, God, you know, I've, you know, not wasted my life, but I've done this. And then, of course, she felt guilty that she hadn't been nicer to him when he was ill and, you know, ugh. Yeah.
Well, it's a cleft stick, isn't it? I mean, you know, you can't win either way on that one. I mean, very, very difficult. But it must have been very good for, and I'm just saying, it must have been very nice for your mum to be able to see, you know, Dead Ringers coming on, which is like one
button. Yeah. Oh, she loved it. Yeah. She absolutely loved it.
You know, and I imagine it was, you know, massive pride and sort of, that's Jan.
It was massive pride. I mean, she sort of gave with one hand and took away with the other. I mean, she was like so proud of me and she wrote me the most lovely letters about how proud she was. And she was sad as well that she was up in the Northwest and we were down here and she didn't see us as much as she'd like and everything. And I remember taking it, when I was married to Max, my second husband, and he was doing very well, and we bought this huge house in Southwest London, and I was taking her around it, showing her what we were going to do to this house. And she just looked around this house and she said, my life's been ashes, absolute ashes. And I don't know if she was starting to get dementia then, because it's such a weird phrase to use. She was jealous of me having a lovely marriage, and she was jealous of my brother having a loving marriage, and she felt like she'd had a bad deal, and she kind of had, actually.
Yeah, it's an impossible situation. That's where you need to have the support, and in these situations, you do have to open up to someone and say, "Look, This is the story here. Because otherwise you're taking it all on your shoulders, massively on your shoulders, and someone else is popping off to the sweet shop.
Well, you see, I think it is quite interesting because she used to say, well, it's one of those things. She'd say that about everything. Well, it's just one of those things, isn't it? And well, you've just got to get on with it. I sort of thank her for that in a way, because I'm so lucky in that I do have the ability to tell other family members, my friends, therapists, you know, when I have episodes of depression or anxiety, I can talk to people about it. So I've got so many things to call on that she never had.
Yeah.
But alongside that, I have this ability, and it must come from her, to just get on with it.
Yeah.
Just get on with it. And I think in the end, make your garden grow. You know, that's all you can do. But we're so lucky now that, I mean, okay, you know, if you try and get a therapist on the NHS, God knows how, you know, the waiting lists are endless. But there are services available. And also there are friends available that you don't need to feel ashamed of sharing these things with.
Absolutely, yeah.
To a degree where actually it's like, oh, shut up about your anxiety. You know, it's like, you know, okay, we've all got ADHD, shut up. You know, it's kind of like everybody's talking about everything all the time. If you're affected by any of the issues in this podcast, call our helpline.
Well, that's
at shedtalks.com.
Yes, that's right. I think I've mentioned this before on this podcast that I do know someone, and I think I told you this, that finds it very difficult to talk to people, and that's a very bad depressive. And it's amazing, you know, he found a farmer friend who had similar problems, who lives 40 miles away, and they're either on the phone or they're on Zoom every week. I think just having somebody to talk to who goes, actually, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Do we have to talk about it? Probably not. But actually, it's so nice for people to go, oh, well, there you go.
Yeah. Oh, I feel that too. Yeah.
You know, and that's huge stuff. The Dead Ringers side is quite extraordinary because it's so successful. Well, I say that because it seems to be that it's 12 years on, it's been on
20 years on.
It's 20 years on. Well, you know,
we started doing it on the radio, yeah, in well, it's 23 in 2000. But you know, it won loads of awards. I mean, I think actually since it won the awards, it's got even better. I think the writers have got,
how many writers are there?
It varies. I mean, I guess there's quite a number of writers who are trying to get material on. There's say about 4 or 6 commissioned writers, and then there's a number of people trying to get stuff on.
But you know, the important thing about Dead Ringers, he says profoundly,
yeah,
is that it makes you laugh.
And, so important,
you know, for this subject that we're on now, you know, and it's go back to your dad, you know, Monty Python, yeah, you know, the Peter Coote and Dudley Moore, and it's so great that you can have something where you go, excuse me, shutting the door now.
Yeah.
Got my radio, got my telly, got my...
Yeah.
I'm watching this, and this makes me laugh.
Laughter is so therapeutic. It's so brilliant. And when I think sometimes that I should have done more with my life, you know, and done something proper and made a difference somehow, I sort of think, well, actually, you know, making people laugh is really not nothing. It's such a kind of... It's such a gift. It's literally a gift. And it's, you know, you're very lucky to have it, to be able to share that sort of, sounding like Thora Heard again, the gift of laughter is a wonderful thing. And it is, you know, it's just such a brilliant thing. And, you know, and even non-performing, you know, I mean, you know, to laugh with your friends, you know, find things in common that you laugh about and have those callbacks to catchphrases. Like,
great. And I think what's great about you is that you are a Rubik cube, really, with your skills and on, you know, it sounds so pompous, skills of impressions, but that's impressionist. But I mean, you know, that's what you can do, isn't it? You have
chicken. Yeah.
But, so there are certain things that we haven't touched on in this.
Yeah, many, many things.
Many, many things. But in a way, I quite like that.
Okay, yeah. I mean, tune in to the next exciting episode where we talk about...
Maybe what we're going to do is we will... Yes, because we haven't talked about... I mean, all the things you've done. I mean, but, you know, and also I found out that very annoyingly for you, you were going to do Talking Heads thing, I think, just before...
Oh, yeah.
It happened.
Yeah, well, we did start doing it. We were 10 days into the run I was doing two of the Alan Bennett monologues at in the theatre, and of course they were closed down when lockdown started. So yeah, that was very sad.
What were they, older, you know, or existing ones, or were they new ones?
No, they were old ones. It was A Lady of Letters, the one that Patricia Routledge did originally.
Oh, yes. The one who wrote letters all the time.
Complains about the neighbours. Yeah, and, great. Yeah. And the other one was this lady who was originally played by Stephanie Cole, who was very sort of, well, we had the funeral, you know, and she kind of finds out she's got this daughter who's clearly a bit sort of challenged mentally and sort of developmentally, I think. That's kind of alluded to. But also what becomes clear is that, you know, she was Daddy's special girl. Oh. And she sort of discovers that over time. But so it's called Soldiering On, that one. Soldiering On. And I'm living, you know, and her son completely rooked her. Her son kind of cheated her out of the hot, you know, put all the money that the father had left into some dodgy deal. And she ended up in a kind of rented flat in Hunstanton. Perfectly good, you know. I go for a swim and the cozzy's a bit, you know, lost its good. Just so, oh. And they're so, I mean, of course, I can't remember any of the lines from them now because I've learned so many other lines since then. But, oh, God, Alan Bennett's lines. I would just so love to do some more Alan Bennett. It's just...
Let's hope he's, as far as I know, he's a very, very serious listener to Shed Talk. So
obviously.
Alan, you know...
Yeah, if you're listening.
You've got the thing. Okay, well, look, that's great. Okay. On that. Brilliant, and brilliant, and brilliant. And I sometimes less is more. And I think what you said, talking about your dad, was very, very moving, touching, but also interesting. And that's what we wanted. Welcome to the Life Jackets section with Jan Ravens. Now, Jan, have you got your form ready?
I have.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I'm very impressed. So the idea of this is, how do you keep sane? What are your life jackets? What keeps you afloat?
Okay.
And some people always say things like the film they always choose is the one with Emma Thompson and Alan Rickman.
Sense and Sensibility.
No.
Oh, Love Actually. Oh, yeah. God.
I know. I know we'll cut this bit, but no, that's what they do. And, you know, and you may say Brief Encounter. You might say Zulu. You might say Ultra Gun.
No, I've got a couple of films that are my...
Okay, well, let's go.
So my first film is a Bette Davis film, and it's called Now Voyager.
Oh.
Bette Davis plays the daughter who's still at home with her mother, Gladys Cooper. Gladys Cooper, don't be so silly, Charlotte. You know, she's very sort of, Charlotte. And Charlotte is kind of slightly overweight, has, you know, bushy eyebrows, thick ankles, frumpy clothes, and smokes secretly up in her bedroom and carves beautiful little sort of wood inlay boxes.
Right.
Anyway, her sister-in-law realizes that Charlotte is not a happy woman. And so she brings along Claude Rains, who's a very wise chap with a pipe, you know, and that lovely, I love Claude Rains. So Claude Rains comes along to the house and Gladys Cooper's very sort of, you know, suspect about all this and, you know, doesn't know what's going on, terribly load of old nonsense and perfectly ghastly and, you know, what's going on. Anyway, he says, I wonder if I might see some of your inlaid boxes, Charlotte. And so she says, why, of course, Dr. Jaquith. And takes him up to the bedroom and he sees that she smokes. And then she said, yes, all right, you see, I'm a fool. I'm the spinster daughter and, you know, I'm worthless and I'm fat and I'm blah, 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 blah. She says, oh, Charlotte, you know, I, why don't you come and stay at my lovely sanatorium? Anyway, Charlotte and Gladys Cooper's, you know, incensed about this, obviously. So anyway, I better cut this short, otherwise it's going to take the whole thing. Bette Davis goes to the sanatorium and then she emerges from, much as I did after my 3 months of Quinsies, she emerges svelte, chic, gorgeous, and on walking along the sort of gangplank onto this cruise boat. And she goes on a cruise, meets Paul Heinried. He's already married, but it's all sort of unhappy and terrible, but they fall in love. And then she sort of relapses and goes back to the sanatorium and she meets this little girl who she realises is Paul Heinrich's very troubled daughter, who's got braces on and is very sort of, I'm ugly and everybody hates me, you know. And so Bette befriends this little girl. And then Paul Heinrich realises and they meet and he says, if only we could be together, Charlotte, you know, and all this. And she says, oh, Jerry, don't ask for the moon. We have the stars. And the violins come in and it's just, so it's got everything. It's got mental illness, ugly duckling story, thwarted romance, you know, being nice to children. It's got all your favourite things in it. And I just love it. And the music is to die for.
And the romanceometer is, you know,
yeah,
really going up to 8.5, possibly 9.
It's beautiful.
Okay, we like that. We like that, Jan. We turn now to the TV series or programme.
Okay.
And, you know, it may be that there is a programme that you return to, and it could be Mr. Bean, it could be Rising Damp, it could be Call My Agent.
You said that sort of like, you know, in capital letters, as if to say, that's the one you have to choose, because yes, I can talk about that one.
It's not. But I mean, what I could say to you is that just looking back at the COVID period, which was not super duper and not terrible in some cases, but was there something you resorted to or a new thing that you liked or, you know, telly or?
Yeah, Tiger King, I think. No. I did watch lots of stuff over lockdown, and there was lots of stuff that I liked. But I think if there was one television programme that I would sort of take to my desert island, as it were, to unfailingly make me laugh and just cheer me up, it would be Victoria Wood as seen on TV.
Right.
Because, oh my God, yeah, the brilliant, brilliant writing and those performances, it's peerless, I think.
Well, there are some. She had some funny mates, didn't she? I mean,
she did Walters, have some funny mates, yeah.
Dina Imrie, and I mean, there's some very funny people that she worked with.
Yeah, I was going to say there's a couple of the songs that I'm not so keen on, which is "Let's Go Down the Chippy" and "Let's All the Ladies Go Shopping" or something, which are a bit. But I mean, then you've got songs like "Let's Do It," you know, and which is just like, oh my goodness, you know. I mean, not only to write that, but to perform it.
She was a very talented, original, interesting creature. I mean,
yeah, and her use of language and her jokes and the rhythms of it, you know, I mean, comedy is so much about rhythm, and she just had the rhythm, had it all going on.
Well, I think actually that Let's Do It is quite an interesting song. I mean, for that, from that point of view, isn't it? Because it's sort of quite jerky and...
Yeah, 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 yeah.
I saw her in 1977-78 playing in a pub in Islington.
At the King's Head?
I think it might have been, actually, yeah. And I remember going up to her in my former life, and I said to her, have you got a recording contract? And she was very sweet, actually, and very proper. She said, I think I'd better talk to my agent. But I don't think she had at the time. But anyway, I think it's a great choice. Great choice. Yes. Okay. Like that. On we go. So books.
Yes.
No.
Books, I think books are a life jacket in themselves. I am such a big reader. And as a kid, you know, I went to Hoy Lake Library kind of on a sort of tri-weekly basis. It was, if that means three times a week. Yeah. I just devour books. Which it actually, and I do read very fast with the result that I quite often don't remember them at all. I always used to say Persuasion by Jane Austen because I could just sort of take such pleasure in the sentences, in the way she constructed sentences and the comedy and the poignancy of the romance. I mean, however, I've had my head turned, Jeremy, by George Eliot.
Oh.
And I'm now I'm saying Middlemarch, which is something of a tome, I have to tell you. You know, it's about 700 or 800 pages or something. It's a biggie, but it's so brilliant on kind of on human nature and on relationships and on pretension and on deceit and hypocrisy and all these things. And again, the elegance of the writing is just amazing. Yeah, it's like so amazing.
Swimming in a river, isn't it? I mean, you know, it's huge stuff to get involved in, but you really get involved.
Yeah, I mean, there's one thing that I do remember from it. I mean, and actually it was one of those books that I underlined things in because I couldn't, and then I kind of collated them all in my Middlemarch quotes because I just didn't want to forget these brilliant things. And one of the things is when Dorothea is on her honeymoon in Rome, and it's absolutely horrible because she's married to this ghastly bloke who just wants to, you know, write his stupid book on the origin of religions or something. And she meets gorgeous Ladislaw in Rome, and she says, "Oh, I don't know anything about art." And she says, and I don't want to know anything about art that not everybody can know, because it feels like it's not fair that I should have this knowledge of these lovely things and not everybody can." And then he says something like, "You know, you don't need to know anything about art. What you need is enjoyment, and enjoyment radiates." And I just thought, that's such a great thing to say. You don't need to kind of know that's that pigment and that symbolizes that and, you know, all that kind of thing. You just got to enjoy it. That, you know, the important thing about art is just to enjoy it. And obviously, sometimes if you do know more about a subject, you can enjoy it. You know, you get a sort of deeper level of enjoyment. Well, maybe it's just a different level of enjoyment. Mm. But basically, that enjoyment of art that it radiates, that's such a potent idea, I think.
Distraction is greatly underrated.
Oh yes, that's one of my things. Yeah, and I guess that's a sort of life jacket as well.
Well, I think that's an important thing to say at this point, because I think one of the great things about reading, whether you are a big reader or you hardly read, that when you feel very fed up, low, all the things we can feel, that actually diving into a small swimming pool of a novel, it can
takes you to a different place. No, and I think all kinds of distraction is, you know, when you have a huge trauma in your life, And distraction can, you know, it can be reading, it can be, you know, going to see a film, it can be, you know, ringing a friend and, you know, hearing what they've got to say and what's going on in their life. It can be, you know, booking a holiday. It can be going to see a band. You know, I think actually when you are going through a hard time, the kind of to sort of build in some distraction, particularly if your horrible thing that's happened has left you a single person. Mm. You know, you need to work hard at that. And yes, that's the sad truth of it, is that, you know, people say, "Oh, poor you," and, "Oh, you must come over." But people aren't saying, "Now, you know, January the 12th. So you've got to go, hi, you know, it's you have to sort of be the one, hey, fancy going to the cinema? Hi, you know, what about going to see this at the National? Or what about, you know, going for this walk or whatever?" You've got to be
being proactive
and, you know, and arranging distraction and creating it for yourself so that by that you create some structure in your life and you know, you don't have this kind of amorphous blob of a life sort of staring you in the face with nothing in it. You know that okay, you're going for a walk, you know, with your chum at that point, and then you're going to go and see your son, and then you're going to see the film with somebody there, and then you're going to go for the weekend with thing. So you sort of know that there's always something to look forward to, I suppose. You hear what I'm saying? It's about, yes, it's about creating structure. And even if you are going to work every day, it still means, you know, you've got to find your pleasure. You've got to find your happy place. Yeah. You've got to find the things that bring you joy and make them happen.
Yes. What about pets?
Well, I had a lovely pet until a year last March. I had a little mini schnauzer called Thora, and she was 13. She died. And the interesting thing is that I was thinking, oh, you know, I must get another dog. But actually, this year I made three intentions. And I thought, you know, my intentions are creativity, independence, and travel. And I have been able to do much more travel this year because I haven't had a dog. You know, while I think a pet is a fabulous thing, you know, so important for a lot of people. I mean, and she was important, you know, she got me through she didn't, but, you know, she helped get me through some tough times. But, you know, there's also that, you know, there's, whatever you do, you've got to think about the dog. You know, well, what will I be back in time to let the dog out? And
but sometimes it might be, I mean, totally accept that. Sometimes it might be great for someone, even if it's just having a hamster, you know, that you have something in your life
to take care of.
A pal, yeah, and take care of, yeah. Yeah.
Did you ever read that book by Atul Gawande? He did the Reith lectures a few years ago, and he wrote a book. I think it's called Being Mortal.
All right.
And one half of it is about dementia, and one half of it is about living with terminal illness. And it's a really brilliant book.
Right. Well, that's we're going to make a note of that book and put it on,
okay,
on the website. Moving on now, the subject is MUSIC. Music.
Okay.
So, Jan.
Yeah. What's my music of choice? Well, that changes all the time, actually. I'm listening to much more classical music now because I can't stand the news on Radio 4 in the morning. So I've been listening to Petrock Trelawney overemphasizing things on Radio 3. I actually, at heart, I'm quite a kind of pop girl, really. But I'm not sure that pop's very good for you because it's sentimental. I mean, my...
What cheers you up? What restraints?
Bruce Springsteen.
Really? Right.
Yeah, I love The Boss. I love The Boss. I'm sort of regretting not going to Hyde Park. But I have been to see him at Hyde Park, and I found the sound felt muted. And I sort of think, I don't know if I've got another kind of looking for the toilet kind of thing. It's all about toilets these days, isn't it? That's the trouble.
I'm sure it's not. But is there
about finding a toilet?
What was the one he did that was quite big? I'm on fire, you're on fire.
Yeah, I'm on fire.
I'm on fire, yeah. I remember that.
Yeah, so
is there one? Or, I mean, have you got, you know, one where you're going, right, Bruce Springsteen, thank you, put it on.
Yeah, I mean, it's very much a cliche, but Born to Run is the go-to one, really, because it's just like, yes!
Right.
You know, we tramps like us, baby, we were born to run, you know, and I love you with all of the madness in my soul. Yes, we're rebels, we're off on our motorbike, I've got my arms around you, and rum, rum, you know, off we go. I used to drive into Cambridge from just outside Cambridge. I had a moped when I was doing my finals, and I used to put Bruce on before I had that. Yes, I can do this. Highways jam with broken heroes on the last chance power drive, and then rum, rum, peep, peep, off on my moped. You know?
On your 150. That's great. Well, I think that sums a lot of things up. I really do.
All that, love it.
Are you, for instance, I mean, I'm just trying to going back now to the hobbies, interests. This will probably not go down well if I say it, but I'm going to say it. Have you ever been into embroidery?
No, I did. I have done some, some tapestry cushions. When I was at the RSC, I had a lead role in one play, and then in another play, I was a really good play, but I was only in about three scenes.
Right.
So I thought, I need a project. And so I made my mum this tapestry cushion with a, she was playing bridge at the time. So I did a sort of pattern of all playing cards. And it was quite the project, I can tell you. But I can sew. I don't think I've ever done embroidery. I used to make patchwork quilts when I was a teenager. Sewing was very much the kind of the thing. My crafty thing. I mean, okay. A friend of mine's just taken up pottery, which she finds absolutely brilliant. She's loving it.
I think anything manual,
Because you get that flow thing, and you sort of, you know, you find yourself doing stuff, and gardening's like that. I mean, I do a little bit of gardening, but you know, gardening is an amazing, because you're so sort of you get that flow thing, don't you? You know, you're so focused on the practical job in hand. You know, you're doing something with your hands, and you're having to think. And
that's something that takes you out of everything.
Yes, and, yeah, fabulous.
I think that's really groovy. So we're coming now, very sadly for us, to the end of the sequence. On the last Shed Talk we had, we have a thing where we say, what would you say to somebody who came to see you, you know, who was not in a great shape, who was your age when it all went wrong for you? That makes sense. And
what would you say?
Well, what would you say to somebody who came to your door,
yeah,
with the same problems that you had when you were 18 in this particular case? What would you say? And in his case, it was very much to do with bipolar. And he was very funny. And he said, I'd invite them in. That was the first thing I'd do.
Yeah.
It was quite sweet. And he said, then the second thing is I would advise them at all costs to get out of bed in the morning. You know, that was a very, very, very long-winded way of asking you, are you good at that, getting up in the morning?
I'm not brilliant. I'm actually a bit sort of concerned about my current routine, because my current routine is I turn Petrov Trelawney on at Radio 3, and then I do the Guardian quick crossword. I do Wordle, Word Hurdle, Quirdle, Octurdle, and then I do the Times quick crossword and the Times 2 code words.
John, you've just dropped that in. I mean, that's...
No, but that's I mean, that takes about half an hour. But what you really should do when you wake up is get the hell out of bed and go and get outside. That's what you really should do. That's what everybody says you should do, is get outside when you wake up. Yeah. And I find I have to take things a bit more slowly than
I think that's pretty good. But you could get out of bed, coffee, and do the crosswords on the kitchen table.
I know, but isn't it quite nice about doing them in bed?
You completely made me feel inadequate now. Okay, so we'll come back to that question in a minute. But there was a Scottish doctor who was called Dr. McTavish, who in 1876 was asked this question. Mm-hmm. What do you need to be happy? And Dr. McTavish said, you need three things. You need something to do, someone or something to love, and something to hope for. What do you think about that?
I think he's hit the nail on the head. I mean, I would say the three things that you need are, well, they're sort of similar, really. I'd say you need love, and that could be friendship or love, or ideally both, but love, health, because health is, you know, so important. And, you know, it's not just health as in make sure you go for a run every day. I mean, you know, some of us are luckier than others with our health.
Mm.
And health is something to be very, very grateful for, which is another thing that isn't a bad idea, being thankful for things, you know, working out what you've got to be thankful for and being it. But the other thing that I think is important that isn't really in your control, it's slightly sort of off subject, I suppose, but the other thing that's really important is safety. I mean, you know, in a lot of places in the world, you know, you can't rely on the fact that you're safe and secure. Mm. And me and Louis, my son, used to have a thing about being safe and secure. When I tucked him up in bed, he'd say, "There you are, safe and secure." and I think that it's sort of just this lovely, you know, it's such a kind of nice idea that, you know, as a child, you can feel safe and secure. And I suppose as a callback to what we were talking about earlier, you know, I didn't feel safe and secure. As a child, it's sort of in my head. So I think safety is pretty much a sort of crucial thing to have for your happiness, because if you're sort of dodging bombs coming in, you know, that's not fun, is it? Love and friendship. And I think there's something to get up for, a purpose, whether that's work or, you know, somebody you're taking care of, or something you're taking care of, or something you're creating, but having a purpose.
Yeah.
As Chrissy Hynde said, give me a sense of purpose, a real sense of purpose. Yeah.
Okay, well, I think that's actually very interesting. I've never heard that about safety. I think it's very interesting. So the
final... Well, I suppose it's not really a mental health thing, is it? It's,
No, actually it is in some ways.
Yeah.
It is very important to be safe. I mean,
well, yes,
that if you have a mental health problem, if you are suffering from...
Anxiety.
Severe anxiety, severe depression, and you go wandering around and you go, "Oh, it's into Mr. Last Train, I don't care."
Yeah.
It is very important to talk about that stuff. You know, it's different take, but be safe.
But also your sense of safety. I mean, if you are anxious, that's the very thing you haven't got. Things don't feel safe. Mm-hmm. Things feel precarious and scary and overwhelming.
Well, we have to find ways of making people feel safe. So the final question, Jan.
Yeah.
Are you steady?
Yeah, go on.
Is there's a knock on the door.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a 10-year-old girl there. Mm-hmm. She says, "I'm having a very hard time because my dad is schizophrenic and I don't know what to do." What are you going to say?
To a 10-year-old kid? I don't know what I'm going to say.
Well, you can make them 14 if you like.
I think looking back, I'd say, well, you know, you'd better make sure you're kind to him. But make sure you're not a nightmare 14-year-old. I think that is the sort of, it's like, well, you know, poor you, you know, I mean, I hope that I would be a person in that situation that I would sort of, you know, I'd sort of, you know, ask her in and say, look, this is a really difficult thing. And, you know, it's really difficult for him and it's really difficult for your mum. And of course, it's really difficult for you. You know, have you talked to anybody else about this? You know, have you spoken to your grandma? Have you spoken to your friends? There's all sorts of, I mean, I'd tell her, me, that there's all sorts of help out there, you know, because now is not then. Now is not when I was a kid. Now is not, there's a huge sense of shame around this and shut up about it. I'd sort of say, well, you know, there's all sorts of things we can do with this. There's people we can go and see. I think being open and being kind and also I'd say, you know, in the time-honoured Max old fashion, I'd say, you know, it's going to be great because this is a really difficult thing, but it's not the end of the world. And many people deal with this on a daily basis and it's a dealable with problem. It's not the end of the world.
I think that's great. And I maybe we'll cut this what I'm about to say, but, you know, I think sometimes people need to know that someone's ill.
Yeah.
And that, you know what I'm saying? That, you know, look.
Yeah.
And when someone's got asthma, a severe attack of asthma, I'm going, it's very easy to know they're ill. But it's not so easy. And the other thing, and I think what you said is totally right anyway, but I don't know whether you want
it's difficult.
Dan, that has been fantastic. I really liked hearing all that. It's really wonderful. And I had thought that we were going to be talking about lots of other things during this. And in a way, I'm glad we haven't, because we've had a very pure experience. And maybe we can one day have Jan part two.
Yes. What happened next?
Yes, I think we both know. Anyway, listeners, we thank you so much for being so groovy, so wonderful. I know you've had to drive all the way from the West Country to make it. And
ironically enough.
I'm really grateful and we love you and it's all going to be flipped off. So do kindly. Thank you.
Thank you.
And it's great to be back in Shed Talks, but much better to be with Karen Cowan. Karen, hi.
Yeah.
That's great. Really good. Good that you're here and back. And here we are, episode 16, Jan Ravens. I found it quite a fascinating episode. What did you think?
I thought it was a wonderful episode, and it was, I thought, perhaps one of the most interesting and hopeful things was that she's made so much of her life and perhaps the adversity of her childhood, particularly things like her mum saying that her own life was ashes and her dad feeling like a beaten man to her.
Yeah.
And Jan seems to have taken it forward and made the very, very most of her life she could.
I think that's right. I mean, she's got a very nice turn of phrase in the sense that she said, you know, right at the end, you know, people have just heard it, make your garden grow.
Exactly.
And I think that is a very interesting way of putting it and saying it. And very lovely way of putting it, actually. Yes, I mean, I agree with you.
And I think perhaps her parents were sort of trapped in the kind of class and things of the day after the war and so on, and not being able to use their intelligence and their skills as much as they might have done as well. And that seems to have really struck home to Jan as well. I wondered if her father had been in the war, actually.
Well, I think he'd been in the Navy. That's what was said anyway. I mean, I think clearly her dad had had a really rough ride in the mental health department, because I think she said that when he'd been in the Navy, and I think he was quite young, you know, which presumably might have been in the war, I don't know, that there had been suicide attempts. And, you know, leading up to her, I think it was, you know, he'd had, you know, the first sort of incarceration, and it sounded like some pretty grim, you know, hospitals that were existing in Cheshire at that time. What was your impression of that?
I got the impression that it must have been hugely difficult. The Diva, the hospital that he went to and that Jan was teased about at school, was very conjures up images of the fear of kind of the old lunatic asylums before the community mental health teams came in.
Yeah.
And it must have been a very, very fearful place altogether, the Diva. I believe it's closed down now, but it would have been terrifying. And also, I would say that in those days, I wondered about, well, even now, some of the diagnoses, because how Jan describes her father doesn't actually, and I'm not really a diagnostician, sound like schizophrenia, but I have known cases, particularly in the past, but also now, of, you know, misdiagnosis of schizophrenia. It sounds a little bit more, but I'm not one to say, like schizoaffective disorder, which perhaps is a mixture of kind of bipolar and with psychotic, you know, psychotic episodes that usually come with the manic period.
Yes. Could we just press the pause button there and just say, I mean, I think what, you know, what would be very helpful to people listening to this is there a straightforward way of explaining schizophrenia to people, what it is, and maybe the different, like, you know, schizoid affective disorder, what the, because there are differences, aren't there, on this illness?
Yes, I suppose the main criteria in DSM-5 for schizophrenia would be the presence of hallucinations or delusions over a relatively long period of time.
Yeah.
So that would be it. But there's also very negative symptoms of schizophrenia, which are, you know, a lack of volition, lack of motivation, lack of interest, all sorts of things. And in the more positive phases or types of schizophrenia, it's much more kind of active and perhaps people wanting to act on their delusions and hallucinations. But that's the main thing, is the criteria would be to be experiencing delusions or hallucinations or hearing voices.
So what would, not trying to be amateur psychiatrist here, but what's the difference between, say, psychosis and that, or is it much the same?
Well, you could it's much the same. I mean, psychiatric diagnosis is such a difficult thing, but psychosis really refers to a discrete episode. So you may experience a period of psychosis, for example, after having taken acid or after having smoked weed for a long, long time, or as part of a depressive episode or of part of a manic episode. And it may be a one-off psychosis episode, but psychosis also is part of schizophrenia in separate episodes. You know, you could have a period of psychosis while you have schizophrenia and then not have the period of psychosis.
Right, right. Yeah. Okay. It was very sort of moving to hear Jan talk about it, because she wasn't sort of being sorry for herself in any way. And I thought that she described her father in a very loving way, actually. But as she said, somebody who'd been sort of battered and beaten by life, not really understanding it. You know, there was a really, oh gosh, that sort of moment where she said that, we'll come on to the family in a minute, but, you know, she said that, you know, her mother always had the moral high ground because he was, you know, going to play golf or, you know, go to football or whatever. And she remembers that moment where, you know, he was doing the washing up and crying, you know, and I just thought that was really very, very poignant.
So did I. And I felt very much when she was talking her huge love for her father.
Yeah.
And it kind of almost felt as if she wished she could have
made him
happier. But what was interesting was she had no kind of knowledge of the possible roots of why it happened, although she did mention that both her parents died when they were in their early teens, which may have had a huge effect.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, true. And also post-war and all of that stuff, as you said. I mean, I'm sort of interested in the sense that it's to know the effect of things like schizophrenia or bipolar on a family, and how a family can cope and can react to the best ways, you know. I don't know if you've got a comment on that.
Well, I think that both things in their sort of florid stages can be very, very frightening for families. And I can see why Jan refers to safety a lot of the time. I mean, now I think things are a lot better. They can, you know, try all kinds of different medications and therapies and everything. And both illnesses, treated correctly, can, you know, it's quite possible to live well.
Yeah.
With them now.
Well, of course, the thing that's changed also is the medication, isn't it? I mean, there wasn't that much medication in 1960, but well, now there is.
Yeah, the medications were coming in. I'm not sure about lithium, actually. I should, and those kind of sodium valproate medicines for bipolar, but very much in the 60s, it was sort of the liquid cosh, Largactyl, chlorpromazine.
Yes.
So, of which the side effects were so huge, and now they, you know, hospitals and psychiatrists nowadays really, really try to medicate people in such a way that they can live. Whereas on the old cosh type drugs, it was very difficult to conduct your life.
Yes. Absolutely. I mean, it just, the great thing, rather, because everyone bangs on about how terrible mental health is these days and da da da, but actually someone ought to say, surely, how great it is in the respect that you can do things now to sort things out. Knowledge is power. We know much more. Families know much more. And worth talking about is that very often a member of a family, particularly an elder member of family, gets a diagnosis, schizophrenia, bipolar, severe depressive, something. And I think the other people in the family, and I've seen this happen, suddenly think, oh my God, I'm going to get it. You know, what, you know, and they rush to Google and to investigate. Do you think that's true? I mean, people do that?
Well, isn't that funny? Because I have actually never really thought of that before, no.
Right.
But I do know that it used to be very much a thing. I remember a friend locally, for example, her mother had schizophrenia, and she was told when she moved into the village nearby, which she moved to, that she should never, ever tell anyone that her mum has schizophrenia because it's inherited. And so I think maybe in the past, I've never heard anybody say that nowadays, but perhaps you have. But
oh yes,
in the past it was, yeah. In the past it was very much considered you're going to have it yourself, you know, if you don't watch out, and the stigma was even greater than it is now.
Yeah, it's just very important to talk about it in a calm way and go, look, this is what it is, because I think so much of the stuff surrounding schizophrenia is sort of driven by, you know, tabloid press, you know, man running down the street naked, or, you know, with axe, or, you know, schizo, and all that crap. And it's very important to contextualize this, I think, and go, look, this is actually what it is, and people can deal with it, especially now, gosh.
Yes, the tabloid press is extremely bad about it. And of course, for example, far more people with untreated schizophrenia are killed and murdered themselves than
oh, really?
actually murder other people. And it's really negligible. I mean, you know, it's
of course.
Far, far more people do violent things than a few people with schizophrenia who if they didn't have it, might have done it anyway, sort of thing.
You know, I thought it was also a very sad but completely understandable picture that Jan drew of her mother. You could sort of sense it completely, you know, what was going on and how she was probably a very, very tough act to be, actually, in those shoes. What do you think?
Yes, I very much thought that, and I was really, really struck by the My Life is Ashes, and very struck by how she always had the higher moral ground, because she was looking after everything and so on. And that's a very difficult family dynamic. Obviously, the ill person can't help being ill, and it's very easy to start getting your self-esteem from I am the martyr kind of thing, and that can cause problems in itself, which luckily nowadays not always, because there's so few resources, is recognised and there's help for that.
Well, interesting. But I guess that if you are a spouse, you know, wife, husband, and you're doing everything, that the key, and the key is to have a support group with your children, if you've got any, and that you actually go, look, right, you take, you know, Sunday afternoon off and, you know, go and have a laugh, you know, that you have to, they have to be looked after as well.
Yeah, very much so. And to have carer breaks. Yes.
Yeah.
Even an hour's break. And in Jan's day, that wouldn't have been recognised, the burden on the carer.
Yeah. But this is, you know, Jan growing up, I thought one of the very, very pertinent things she said was that she didn't like being the little girl. Because she had no power. I thought, I've never heard that sort of thing before, but I got it.
I can completely recognise that you want to be able to sort things out. But as a child, you don't have any power. You can't go to the council and say, you know, excuse me, can we have a bigger house? You have absolutely no power. And I can see that Jan has worked to sort of get power in her life.
Yes, that's absolutely true. And in a way, by becoming an impressionist at school. And then, you know, I thought it was very funny when she said, she was very honest, and she said, well, I was ill when I was 13, and then I lost a lot of weight, and then suddenly I looked like the, you know, the swan coming out.
Yes, yeah, wonderful. And wonderful that she learned very quickly how to survive, for example, at school doing impressions and being funny. The people had teased her before, but I expect once she did the impressions and became funny, you know, it was stopped.
Yes, absolutely. But, you know, you then look on, you know, going on through Jan's life, it's A, had she'd always been that confident, but B, I mean, it's extraordinary that could you skydive off Beachy Head? All right, then. Most of us would be going, actually, where's the other way?
Well, I wonder, in a strange sort of way, if her dad, who sounded so loving, gave her a form of confidence, as well as the idea that she didn't want to be like her mum and dad, and she wanted to try everything and not be afraid of failure.
Jan has consistently, you know, whether it's being on Strictly Come Dancing, surviving five rounds of that, to Dead Ringers. I mean, she's done lots and lots of different things and been successful.
Yes, her life is certainly not ashes.
I love that bit about laughter and the importance of it, because you sort of think, if you're a comedian, whatever, and a big impressionist like she is, you'd be going, well, obviously you don't need to talk about that. But I thought she was very real about that's what we need, whatever that resets us, gets us going.
Yes, exactly. I'd be very interested to know about her father's background and what actually happened. But we don't know that. And as in the old days, you know, you probably didn't really ask.
Yes. I can see the duality of her relationship with her mother, that it was very, very sad in many ways and sort of kind of irritating in some as well.
Yes, she must have really wanted her mum to sort of have a bit of fun kind of thing.
Yeah.
And it was interesting that she spoke quite a bit about how her father was recommended to do all these fun things. But as you say, her mother wasn't recommended those things, whereas that would be a bit different nowadays.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I we'll finish on this, that, and I don't want it to be a negative, but going back to that thing that she said, growing up, she always had this feeling of a nameless dread that her family were different to other families, you know, growing up. And I don't just think that's an economic thing, obviously, with all the mental illness and everything. But maybe that has stayed with her in a, you know, a small dark corner somewhere. Maybe she keeps it in a wardrobe and takes it out now and again. And, you know, because she's, as I say, she's fearless. So I think she would confront
it. I suppose the idea that your father might die at any moment would also cause a lot of nameless dread, obviously. But also, for a child, being different in any way, your family being different, is, you know, a horrendous experience sort of thing. They just want everything to be completely the same as everyone else, don't they?
Yes. Yeah. No.
And they don't realise that behind closed doors, nobody is the same.
Episode, very thought-provoking. And what I love, this is my last thought, I love it that she, going back to that, make your garden grow. And here we are in the shed, and this is in the middle of the garden, and it's very, very inspirational. So thank you, Jan Ravens. We like that. Last comment, Karen.
Well, I think she really, really has made her garden grow. And I think overall, the whole programme shows us that let's carry on advancing things so that mental illness is viewed as something just like other illnesses that can be dealt with, ameliorated, helped.
Brilliant. Yeah, I think that's great. Really great to talk to you. Fantastic. We are going to be building a new website soon, and we're going to have a lot more information about things that we've been talking about. So stand by your telephones and whatever. Thank you, Karen. You're tip top and totally tidy as ever. See you next time.
See you next time.
So it's time for the credits. Lukey Tupman. Great to have you on board, Luke. That's very great. Thank you very much for all your efforts and everybody else who has contributed to make Shed Talks what it is today. Thank you so much. Be groovy and onwards and upwards, tip top and tidy.